Good evening. My name is Stacy, and I handle adult education here at the North Carolina Museum of History. And it's my honor to virtually welcome all of you to this evening's very special program, Chasing My Cure with Dr. David Fajgenbaum. Tonight's program is just one of many exciting virtual offerings available through MOH. So if you'd like to learn more about our History at Home initiative, we invite you to head over to the museum's website at www.ncmuseumofhistory.org. We would like to take this opportunity to thank our North Carolina Museum of History Associates and Foundation for making tonight's program possible. Our Associates and Foundation provide crucial funding and support to the museum, which, in addition to many other things, helps make programming like this evening's event possible. If you'd like to learn more about becoming an Associates member, please head over to their website at www.ncmoha.com. We would also like to take this opportunity to thank those of you who donated funds towards this evening's program. We do our best to keep our programs free to attend, but there are costs associated with keeping our programs going, and we continue to be so appreciative of you and your generous support of the museum. So thank you so much. I also want to take this opportunity to remind all of you that Chasing My Cure, the book about Dr. Fajgenbaum's story, recently featured on CNN and in the Washington Post, can be purchased at our museum shop. You can order yours online and arrange for in-store or curbside pickup or postal delivery, complete with a signed bookplate by the author for newly purchased copies for a limited time. So definitely head over to the museum shop's website and grab your copy. A few quick housekeeping items for this evening. We ask that you please keep your mics muted throughout the entirety of tonight's program, and to please type any questions that you have for our guest speaker into the chat function located at the bottom center of your screen. At the end of the program, I will ask the speaker as many of your questions as time allows. So it's my honor to introduce this evening's speaker, Dr. David Fajgenbaum. Dr. Fajgenbaum is a national best-selling author, disease hunter, and groundbreaking immunologist at the University of Pennsylvania. After being diagnosed with Castleman disease during medical school and nearly dying 5 times, he dedicated his life and career to finding innovative treatments for deadly conditions, including COVID-19, all while still fighting one firsthand. Okay, Dr. Fajgenbaum, I'm gonna turn it over to you. Welcome. Thanks so much for taking the time to be here with us this evening.
Oh, Stacy, thanks so much for that introduction. It's so special to be with all of you today. I wish we could be together in person, but really special for me to be able to share my journey chasing my cure with so many people that have been on that journey with me. And in my case, I started my journey chasing my cure in Raleigh, North Carolina. So this is just a really special evening for me. Tonight, I'm going to share some images with all of you through some slides. As I mentioned, I titled my talk Chasing My Cure, and my book Chasing My Cure is really something that I wrote to share the lessons I learned about life and hope and resilience for my journey chasing after a cure with all of you. But I would start first when I went from being this healthy medical student to nearly dying for the first time in the intensive care unit just down the street from many of you in Durham at Duke, when I had my last rites read to me because the doctors didn't think I would survive. That moment when a priest came into my room and read my last rites to me, I considered that to be the start of my overtime. Time that I didn't think that I would have, but time that I tried to make the most of every second. And so if you use the analogy of overtime, extra time you didn't think you'd have. And I thought I would go back to what the first half of my life would be. And the first half of my life, if overtime started in November of 2010, would have been growing up in Raleigh, North Carolina. I grew up in Raleigh with the most amazing sisters and supportive parents. I dreamed of one day playing college football, and I played football at Ravenscroft. I learned about the importance of working hard from my mom and my dad. I learned about being a compassionate supporter from my mom and developed so many incredible friends while I was in Raleigh. Shortly after graduating from high school, this picture is actually from my high school graduation day, my life really changed. And this is what I consider to kind of be the halftime of my life, a really big turning point when everything changed. And that was a couple of weeks after I left home to go to college at Georgetown when my mom was diagnosed with brain cancer. She was the most incredible person in the world. And the idea of this incredible person, my best friend and the most amazing mom, being diagnosed with brain cancer, just broke my heart. It shattered me to my core. I remember the first thing that, of course, we all did was say, well, we've got to get her to the world's expert. Where do we go? And we learned that at Duke, just down the road, there was the best brain tumor center in the world. And I remember walking into the hospital and seeing this sign, at Duke, there is hope. And I remember feeling hopeful, knowing that we were at the right place where they would be able to take care of my mom. And I remember even asking the doctors after surgery, what is the longest that anyone has ever lived with this form of cancer that my mom has? And they said, you know, one person lived about 5 years. And I was convinced that my mom was going to live 5 years in one day. Because she was that kind of person, that kind of a fighter, that I just believed with everything in me that she would have the longest period fighting brain cancer there was. During my mom's battle, I learned so much from her about grit and just being graceful in the midst of tragedy and challenging times, and learned so much, so many lessons that I took with me. Unfortunately, just about a year after her diagnosis, she passed away. And as I mentioned, this experience of her diagnosis and her passing really feels like the halftime of my life, because it was so critical in shaping and directing my future, because it really was so challenging for me to personally, and for my sisters and for my dad to cope with. But shortly before she passed away, I promised her I would do a couple things. And I said, Mom, I'm going to start an organization in your memory called AMF. It's going to be a support network for grieving college students. My mom's name was Anne-Marie Fajgenbaum, and AMF would be her initials would also stand for Ailing Mothers and Fathers. I also promised her that I would dedicate my life to searching for treatments in memory of her. I would go to medical school and try to find cures for diseases like the one that ailed her. We spent a lot of time trying to raise awareness, and thanks to a lot of supporters from the Raleigh area that helped to raise the profile of AMF, we really raised national awareness about the challenges of college students like me coping with the illness or death of a loved one. At one point, I was on the back of 40 million bags of Doritos in an effort to raise awareness. And we really were able to get college student grief out there. And it was so special for me to hear about how AMF was helping someone at UNC, or AMF was helping someone in California. And the idea that my mom, AMF, that her memory, her legacy could continue on was so special for me. So fast forward a few years, and now I'm in the second half of my life. I was in medical school at Penn, and I was really making progress as a third year med student towards my goal of one day treating patients in memory of my mom, when, as I shared earlier, I became critically ill. And was hospitalized and then eventually transferred to the intensive care unit because my liver, my kidneys, my bone marrow, my heart and my lungs were all shutting down for an unknown cause. I literally was actively dying in front of the doctors, and no one had any idea what was going on. I was so sick that I was getting dialysis daily, blood transfusions daily. I had a retinal hemorrhage that made me blind in my left eye temporarily. I gained 70 pounds of fluid, and I drifted in and out of consciousness, all with no diagnosis. Weeks went by of me fighting for survival without a diagnosis. And in the midst of this challenging time, a family friend offered a phone number to my dad of a doctor at the NIH. And my dad didn't know who he was, but the idea was that maybe if we called this doctor, that he might have some ideas for how to diagnose this frightening condition that I was dealing with. And so my dad started calling this doctor every day and would talk to him for 30 to 45 minutes every day, what my lab tests were, what was going on. And every day he would give my dad ideas, and they kept, you know, working towards a diagnosis. About 6 months later, when I got out of the hospital, I asked my dad, I said, Dad, who was that doctor that you were calling when I was in the ICU? I don't really remember much, but who was it? And he said, I don't know. Betty Jacobs gave me his number, and I think his name's Fucci. You should Google him. And so I Googled Fucci, NIH, and I immediately learned that this was Dr. Tony Fauci, that my dad had been calling every day and had been speaking to every day for weeks. And my dad never went to the effort to figure out who Dr. Fucci or Fauci was. He'd actually already won a Presidential Medal of Freedom. But the reason I share this story is A, for those of you from Raleigh who know my dad, you'll probably get a chuckle imagining this, but really B, the main reason that it highlights just how far our loved ones will go to do anything for those of us when we're battling illness. My dad would have done anything in the world to find an answer for me, including Hound, a director at the NIH, who many of us now know well. Unfortunately, despite Dr. Fauci's best efforts and my dad's best efforts, they still couldn't figure out a diagnosis. And weeks and weeks into my journey, we struggled to know what was going on. I dealt with unbearable pain on a daily basis because of the fluid around my vital organs, creating really just awful pain. And I remember knowing that I wasn't going to survive. The doctors knew I wouldn't survive. My family knew it. I knew that I wasn't likely to survive more than a couple of days. And I remember thinking to myself that I'm only going to survive a couple more days. I'm in so much pain. Maybe I should just give up. And that really was the lowest point of my life, when I literally, there was a 1 second period where I looked at the telephone cord in my room and I thought to myself, maybe I should just give up. I'll be giving up on a couple of days of life, but it's suffering and it's pain. And maybe that telephone cord will give me the freedom that I need from this pain and this suffering. But thankfully, that thought only lasted for 1 second. And I realized that I couldn't just give up. I had to keep fighting. Even if I was only fighting for one more hour or one more day, I was going to keep pushing with everything I had to survive. And of course, if I had given up, I would have thought that I was giving up on just 2 days of life. I would have never have known that I was giving up on over a decade of life and memories and progress in medical research. Right around that time was when the priest came in and read my last rites to me. And as I said at the beginning, I've really considered that to be the start of my overtime. I'm going to read a passage from my book. The experience of being in overtime is surprisingly one of intense awareness and scrutiny and clarity. There's a reason for that. When there are only a few seconds left on the board, all distractions disappear and the purpose of victory becomes clear. The present is only the things around you, and overtime is all present, nothing but present and purpose. And so for me, it was terrifying being in overtime early on, but I've found that now it can be clarifying. It's recognizing and appreciating that we have a limited amount of time, but it's making sure, because we know we have a limited amount of time, that we spend our time in the most important ways with the people that we love the most. I knew a little bit about overtime and I understood overtime. I mentioned from my football playing days at Georgetown, unfortunately, we lost a lot more football games than we won or went into overtime. But I did understand that sense of really making the most of every second. You can make a mistake in the first half and make up for it, but you can't in overtime. And that's the kind of sense that I live with, of being in overtime now, of really making sure that I live in the right way and do the right things. During college, I met my girlfriend, Caitlin. Caitlin and I started dating for a few years. Shortly before I became ill, we decided to take a break. And I remember vividly thinking to myself, you know, we're 25 years old, we've got all the time in the world. If it's meant to be, it's meant to be. And, you know, no need to fight for this relationship. And then there I was, just a few months later in the intensive care unit, having my last rites read to me. And so I made a commitment to myself that if I were to survive, that I would no longer live a life thinking if it's meant to be, it's meant to be. That if I thought of something and it was the right thing to do, that I would pursue it. And so it came from the very simple realization that the regrets that ate at me the most as I prepared to die weren't about anything I'd done. My greatest regrets were things that I had thought of doing but never did. It's the absence of memories that you wish you had made and the realization that you'll never get the chance to make them that was so painful for me. Fortunately, with the diagnosis came treatment. I got a combination of 7 different chemotherapies, and I should mention what that diagnosis was. I was diagnosed with idiopathic multicentric Castleman disease, which is a rare condition that's kind of a cross between an autoimmune condition and a lymphoma. And we don't really know how to categorize it, but we knew at the time that our best option for survival against this deadly illness is to use chemotherapy. And so I was treated with a combination of 7 different chemotherapies. But thankfully, it saved my life just in time. And you can see my dad here with me. I'm sitting up and smiling. still got a really big belly because my liver and my kidneys had shut down. And so I just flew it all over my body. But you can tell I'm just so thankful to be alive in these pictures and so thankful to have my dad by my side. The photograph from the right of the screen is from New Year's Eve 2010. Just want to share a quick anecdote from that evening. My dad and I decided to take a walk around the hospital. At this stage, I'd been hospitalized for about 5 months. And we decided to take a walk on New Year's Eve. And at about 8 p.m., we passed the family waiting room and we saw that there was a gentleman who was kind of swaying in his chair. He looked like he'd clearly been drinking on New Year's Eve. And on our next lap around the hospital, we saw that he'd fallen onto the ground. And so my dad ran over to this drunk guy and he helped him back into his chair. And he looked at my dad and I and he said, "Thanks so much. Good luck to you and your wife." I said, "Wife, what is he talking about?" And then I looked down at my belly and I realized he thought that I was my dad's pregnant wife and that we were walking laps to deliver our child on New Year's Eve, which was a low point emotionally for both of us, but we managed to laugh so hard. Sometimes in life, in our most challenging moments, if you don't laugh, then I think you'll cry. And for us, we laughed so hard together. And I found that in the midst of tough times, laughing with the people you love is so, so important. That facing my horrible moments with laughter was just as fundamentally a rejection of Castleman's dominion over me as anything else I was doing. It cleared my mind, it stiffened my resolve. It was entirely up to me to determine what was and what wasn't funny. Perhaps most important, humor is social. For me and my family, there was never a better way to reset our collective resolve than laughing together. I was eventually discharged from the hospital about 2 months later. And you can see when I got out of the hospital, how big my belly was, how I was bald from chemotherapy, and maybe how someone might have confused me as my father's pregnant wife. And this is a picture from a few years before when I played football at Georgetown. And I always say this is the worst before and after pictures of all time. But if we could flip the order, it could be this great advertisement for Muscle Milk or for Peloton. But unfortunately, the pictures are in the wrong order. Did take a picture every week for the next 8 weeks, and you can see my hair starting to grow back. You can see my belly starting to shrink away. I look a little bit less like my father's pregnant wife by the end. A picture from the side as well. And you can see hair growing back and my belly shrinking away. So when I got out of the hospital, the first thing I did was reach out to Caitlin and tell her that I had just regretted that I hadn't fought for our relationship and that I wish I had, that was my biggest regret as I thought I was not going to survive, but that I hadn't fought for our relationship. And I was so thankful to learn that she felt the same way as me. And so we started dating shortly thereafter. And this is the first Halloween after we started dating again. And some of you all may recognize I'm dressed as Borat in this picture. I'm a huge Borat fan. And so nothing could be better than dating Caitlin again and being dressed as Borat on Halloween. But I think this picture on the right, I like even more. It's certainly more special to me. And that's from just a few months later when I was getting an experimental drug, a drug that we hoped would keep my disease in remission. It was the only drug in development for my disease. And we hoped that infusions of it every 3 weeks would keep me alive and keep my Castleman disease at bay. And during one of my infusions, the nurses let me leave the infusion clinic with the drug on my shoulder. So you can see on my left shoulder, I've got this infusion pump pumping this type of experimental drug into my veins through my port. And then on my other shoulder, I've got Caitlin supporting me. And I think that this is such an important and perfect symbol of what my life's been like over the last decade. Medical technology on one side helping me to move forward, and my family, my friends, my loved ones on the other side, helping to support me along the way. I was able to return to medical school at Penn as a third year med student, and right around then a large donation was made to Penn to start an orphan disease center, or a rare disease center, which of course I immediately got involved in. But unfortunately, just a few months later, I started to have signs of a relapse. All of my blood tests started coming back, suggesting that my liver, my kidneys, my bone marrow, my heart, and my lungs were shutting down again. And that was even though I was on this experimental drug. And I show this picture in particular, it's my dad buzzing my head. And that's because this was the day that they started chemotherapy. I mean, fortunately, I was early enough in the disease course that we picked it up before I was completely unconscious and incapacitated. But I was starting, my organs were starting to shut down, and they started me on a combination of 7 chemotherapies. And this is actually a pretty important moment in my journey that I talk about in my book quite extensively. And that's that this is the moment when I went from being hopeful that some drug would be developed by someone somewhere to help me, to really saying that I was no longer just going to be hopeful. I was going to be hopeful and I was going to start taking action. And the first action was really simple, but it basically was, okay, all of my hair is going to fall out from chemotherapy, but I'm done letting chemotherapy or my disease be in control. I'm going to lose my hair because I'm going to have my dad buzz my hair. And again, it may seem really, really simple, but that day my dad buzzed my hair. And of course the little bit that was left over started falling out over the next couple of weeks. But this was just kind of the first start of me saying, I'm no longer going to be the victim. I'm going to lose my hair because I want to lose my hair. This is a picture from just a few weeks later. In the meantime, I had an important conversation with my doctor where he explained to me that there were no more drugs in development. There were no more promising leads. The only drug that had any potential to help me didn't work for me. I was out of options. And after he left the room, I turned to my dad, my sisters, and Caitlin, and I said, I'm going to dedicate the rest of my life, however long that may be, trying to find a treatment that could maybe help me and patients like me. And you can certainly see from this picture that I was locked in, and that I knew it was unlikely that I was going to make progress in time to save my life. But I knew that I had no shot of survival if I didn't get involved in searching for a treatment. So I returned to medical school at Penn. And though there was no one doing research into Castleman's at Penn, a colleague of mine in the pulmonology department provided me some laboratory space where I could start doing Castleman's research. And I started a foundation called the Castleman Disease Collaborative Network to bring together physicians, researchers, and patients from around the world to advance research for Castleman disease in a really new and innovative way. Rather than raising money and then hoping the right researcher applies for the right project at the right time, we would actually crowdsource from within the community, patients, physicians, researchers, what's the most important research questions, and then go out and recruit the best researchers in the world to do that science. And that's really been a game changer and led to incredible progress. As I shared before, this was such a critical turning point for me. And it really had to do with how I thought about hope. Hope cannot be a passive concept. It's a choice and a force. Hoping for something takes more than casting out a wish to the universe and waiting for it to occur. Hope should inspire action. And when it does inspire action in medicine and science, that hope can become a reality beyond your wildest dreams. But now that I was out of the hospital and I was hopeful that there would be a treatment for me, but I was also taking action to search for treatment, the first thing I did was to get a sense for, well, what was being done for idiopathic multicenter Castleman disease, which is the rare disease that I suffer from. Well, I learned that about $10,000 a year was going towards what's called translational research. That's research to try to find new treatments. $10,000 a year was really unlikely to make enough progress. The NIH had never given a single dollar towards research for Castleman disease. There were no patients in a registry because no registry existed. There were 2 advocacy organizations, but there was no sort of research plan or infrastructure for how to put forward the science. There were no cell lines or animal models or biobanks. The disease, as you can imagine, was very poorly understood. No diagnostic criteria. Diagnosing Castleman disease required having a doctor who was familiar with it, who just knew what to look for, but there was no sort of checklist or criteria to diagnose it. There were no treatment guidelines. What do you do when you diagnose someone with Castleman? There were no blood tests you could run that could predict whether someone was likely to benefit from one chemotherapy or another chemotherapy. There were no FDA-approved treatments, but there was one drug in development. However, that one drug in development didn't work for me. So as scary as it was to be in the hospital, and especially that fourth time when I nearly died for the fourth time, as scary as that was, it was almost even more scary to be out of the hospital and to understand what the field looked like. Now, I mentioned that one drug that was in development. It's based on research done by Dr. Kazu Yoshizaki, who's photographed here. We're both doing what we call the Castleman Flex. Kazu discovered that a particular protein called interleukin-6 was really elevated in Castleman disease years ago, and he developed a drug that blocks that particular protein from doing its function. And I'd heard a rumor that Kazu tested the drug on himself as the first human before he gave it to Castleman's patients. And when I asked Kazu, I said, Kazu, I heard that you gave tocilizumab to yourself. He said, No, I didn't give it to myself. The nurse, she gave it to me. Said exactly Kazu. So Kazu discovered the target of this drug. He developed the drug. He tested it on himself, proved that it was safe. He didn't die. So he went on to give it to other Arthur Castleman's patients in Japan, and it got approved in Japan for Castleman disease. Years later, it went on to get approval here in the United States for rheumatoid arthritis. And when a young girl named Emily Whitehead was the first pediatric patient to ever receive something called cellular immunotherapy, which is a type of treatment for cancer patients, she was the first patient to receive cellular immunotherapy, and she ended up in the ICU at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, just down the road from where I am. And when she was in the ICU, her doctors observed that her features looked very much like Castleman disease. So they tried this Castleman disease treatment on her, and it saved her life. This drug that Kazu developed decades before for Castleman's, which was now being used for rheumatoid arthritis here in the US, saved Emily Whitehead's life. And in doing so, it likely saved the entire cancer cellular immunotherapy program, which is really our best and brightest opportunity in all of cancer research right now. The entire program would have likely been shut down if Emily had passed away, highlighting how these drugs developed for rare conditions can really have an outsized impact. And when COVID emerged and it became clear that the most sick COVID patients looked just like the most sick Castleman disease patients, doctors started reaching for tocilizumab, that same Castleman's drug that Kazu had developed, and started giving it to COVID patients. And anecdotally, it seemed to be helpful in a number of these patients experiencing what's called a cytokine storm, where your immune system is out of control. There were a number of clinical trials done. Some of them looked really promising. Some of them looked less promising. But more recently, it's been clear in the absolute biggest studies that this drug, tocilizumab, developed for Castleman disease by Kazu, tested on Kazu decades ago, is effective for the most severe COVID-19 patients. Again, highlighting that these drugs developed for rare diseases can oftentimes have a really outsized impact. So understanding where the field was and how much progress needed to be made, I knew the first thing I needed to do was to connect with other Castleman's patients. So I held a webinar and I invited a number of Castleman's patients to join me for that webinar and to share my vision for what I wanted to accomplish. And kind of a bit as a joke, but I showed this image as a Castleman. And I said, you know, what do you think about this being our new logo for the Castleman disease field? So my disease is called Castleman disease. It's actually named after a doctor named Benjamin Castleman, but I decided to repurpose it as a Castleman. And our community liked it, but they're like, you know, Dave, I think you can do a better job. And so we drew a new Castleman, and this became our new Castleman logo. And actually, I have it on my jacket. Our community loved it. They were like, we love this logo. This is it. This is what we're going to move forward with. And so 2 weeks later, this showed up on our Facebook page. One of our patients had screenshotted it and got it tattooed on his shoulder. And I always say, if this is not patient engagement, then I don't know what patient engagement is, because our patient community was just waiting to get behind this. And now there are literally hundreds of Castleman tattoos on patients all over the US. These are just some of the Castleman's patients that are part of our community. About 5,000 patients are diagnosed each year in the US, which makes it about as common as ALS, but obviously a lot less public awareness for Castleman disease. Among patients with Castleman disease, particularly my subtype, the most deadly subtype, a third of us will die within 5 years of diagnosis, and another third will die within 10 years of diagnosis. I have the most severe subtype within that subtype, so our life expectancy is far shorter. These are some of the many patients. You can see one patient who was diagnosed before his first birthday, other patients that are diagnosed much later in life. It really affects anyone and everyone. And we worked so hard for every one of these patients. Once we had the patient community connected, and the next step was to try to build a team. At the time I was a medical student, and then I went on to go to business school. And I knew that I needed to build a team of colleagues that could be a part of fighting back against Castleman disease. So I turned to my classmates and my friends and friends in Raleigh to build this team. And you can see many, many people came together to be a part of the CDCN and still are a part of the CDCN. We're doing what's called the Castleman Flex. It's kind of like the idea of like a Castleman warrior. And if we were all in person today, I would have all of you stand up and do a Castleman warrior flex. But maybe the best I can ask for is that you'll maybe do a Castleman flex in front of your computer and post it on the social media to help us to raise awareness. With the patient community in hand, with the volunteer team in place, We then turned to the physician researcher community, and we began recruiting physicians and researchers to be a part of our network, something called CDCN Connect, with the idea being that we wanted to connect everyone so we could get the best and brightest research ideas from physicians and scientists so that we could then go out and identify the best people in the world to do the research study. So let's use the whole community to prioritize ideas and let's go out and do the most important research. When we started up, there was one study in process for Castleman disease back in 2012. Today, there are well over 30 studies underway. I wish I had time to go through all of them, but I'll encourage you to go to cdcn.org/research if you want to take a look at our various studies and where they stand. So in the midst of this progress, creating the CDCN, conducting research, making progress scientifically, I graduated from medical school. This is Caitlin and I on my graduation day. And shortly after this picture was taken, Caitlin and I got engaged, and we were so excited about one day getting married. And then I relapsed and I nearly died for the fifth time. What was so tough about this relapse was that I was on a weekly chemotherapy regimen that we had hoped would keep me in remission. And it really was the final last-ditch effort. That experimental drug didn't work. This is the last shot to say maybe weekly chemotherapy will prevent my disease from coming back. And unfortunately, it couldn't. And I spent another month in the ICU fighting for survival. And I don't have much time tonight to go through the details of it, but it was so frightening for the fifth time to nearly die. And thankfully, that combination of 7 chemotherapy agents again saved my life. But when I got out of the hospital, I knew that I wasn't likely to survive any more of these relapses. And I was also approaching the lifetime max of a number of the chemotherapies I had received. So I really was running out of options. And I had a really important date in front of me, and that was Caitlin and I's wedding date, May 24th, 2014. All I wanted to do was to make it to May 24th, 2014. I didn't care if I made it to May 25th, 2014. I just needed to make it to May 24th to our wedding date. And I would do anything in the world, whatever it was, I would have done anything in the world to make it to that day. But I knew the only way I could survive that day is if I could find a treatment that could maybe keep me alive and enable me to make it to that day. And so fortunately, I'd been collecting blood samples on myself and even had a lymph node biopsy performed when I was very sick. So that way I could actually have data and samples that I could try to find maybe a clue about a drug that could be used to treat my disease. So I took those blood samples, I ran something called serum proteomics on them. I took my medical data, I found all the cytokine results, all these various immune protein, the levels of them. I ran something called flow cytometry on my immune cells to understand which immune cells in my blood were activated, which ones weren't activated. And then I ran a series of analyses on these data to try to see if there were any themes, any signals within the data that could help us to predict a drug that might be able to treat my disease. I mean, at this stage, we were completely out of options. There were no leads. So this was our attempt to find some leads. And from the data, we found one thing that came out. And that's that a particular communication line in the immune system called the PI3 kinase AKT mTOR signaling pathway seemed to be activated. All of my blood samples suggested to me that maybe this part of the immune system was turned on. And what was exciting or promising about that is that there were a number of aspects of my clinical case that would line up with this particular communication line being too turned on. And if it's turned on too much, then that could lead to potentially the immune system getting out of control. You can think about it almost as like a fire alarm. And if your fire alarm is constantly on, then firefighters may constantly be, trying to put out fires, even if there aren't fires. And so that's kind of like what was happening or what we thought was happening based on these experiments. But there was a really important step that we had to do, and that's to validate what we were finding. So in research and in science, weird things can happen and random chance is really complicated to deal with. And so we wanted to validate what we thought we were seeing. And so I did a really important experiment, really an experiment that saved my life. And that is that I went back to that lymph node that I actually had asked to get removed when I was relapsing. It was done at UNC. Went back to that lymph node and I ran an experiment. I asked, is this particular communication line in the immune system, is it turned on in my samples when I'm sick, or at least turned on more than in healthy individuals? And so the first thing I did was to run this experiment on normal lymph nodes. And what I found, and so this particular communication line is positive is brown. So if it's if you see on the screen brown, that means there's some of this communication line turned on. If it's blue, it's not turned on. You can see in a normal lymph node that there's some brown. There's some aspect of mTOR activation. This communication line is in the on position in at least some cells in a normal person. And then this is my lymph node, and you can immediately appreciate there's a lot more mTOR activation. There's a lot more brown staining in my lymph node. And so we thought that the mTOR pathway might be important from the blood test that we ran, but this really confirmed that this pathway was turned on. It didn't guarantee that turning it off with a drug would be effective, but it really was a very promising lead. Fortunately, there's a drug called sirolimus that's been around for 30 years that's really good at inhibiting the mTOR pathway. It's a very good at turning it off. It has an incredible history that I don't have time to go into tonight. It was discovered actually in the Pacific Islands, Easter Island, in the soil of this remote island. And now this molecule, rapamycin or sirolimus, is used to treat individuals with kidney transplants to prevent them from rejecting their organ. And based on what I was looking at in front of me, I thought to myself, I need to try sirolimus. I need to get this drug. And so I started testing this drug on myself because I was out of options and I had to make it to May 24th, 2014. And I would have done anything to make it to that date. Today marks 86.61 months that I've been in remission. And I say 86.61 months because I know that I can't round up. I don't know if I'm going to be in remission for 87 months on this treatment, but I also refuse to round down. It's 86.61 months. And that fraction, every fraction of a month, a week, a day, an hour, I am so, so thankful for. And when you think about this in the context of how I nearly died five times in 3.5 years and now have been in remission for over 7 years, just hard to put into words what that means. The New York Times called this Doctor Cure Thyself, which I think is a bit of an overstatement. I think it should probably be doctor helping himself a little bit right now and hopefully for a lot longer, fingers crossed. But I don't think there was room for that. But importantly, during this long remission, which I don't like to call a cure, but during this long remission, Caitlin and I were able to make it to our wedding day. This is May 24th, 2014. And actually you can see my hair grew back just in time for the wedding, which may not seem that important, but for me, I wanted to have my hair back on my wedding day because I didn't want the external reminder of all that I had already put Caitlin through and all that I likely would continue to put her through in our relationship. A couple of years ago, we had our daughter, Amelia. This is Amelia around her first birthday. Just it's been so special and so amazing to have Amelia in our lives. This is Amelia, Caitlin, and I at Halloween this past year. You can see we've dressed Amelia as Amelia Earhart, and Caitlin and I are Amelia's aviation crew, which I actually think is like the perfect symbol for how things are in our house. Amelia is the boss, she is the pilot, and we just kind of try to redirect her in the direction that we need to take her in. During this remission, I also joined the faculty at the University of Pennsylvania, where I had previously been in medical school and then business school, and I started a center called the Center for Cytokine Storm Treatment and Laboratory. The initial focus of the center, what we call the CASTLE, was to focus on Castleman disease and the cytokine storm, basically immune hyperactivation that occurs with a number of cancer treatments, these cellular immunotherapies, and to apply cancer treatments to Castleman and Castleman treatments in the setting of cancer. And then a year ago, when the COVID pandemic erupted, it became clear that in the most sick COVID patients, they also were experiencing a cytokine storm very similar to Castleman disease, very similar to what we were seeing in these cancer cellular immunotherapy patients. And so we decided to redirect a significant portion of our work towards COVID-19. We launched something called the Corona Project, which you can learn about at cdcn.org/corona. It actually was on a car ride. You all may remember Friday the 13th of March last year, which was the day that the US really shut down. And I was driving down to Raleigh with Caitlin. We wanted to come down to see my sister and my brother-in-law, Chris, who was battling ALS at the time. And with the shutdown happening, we didn't know when we would be able to get down to Raleigh to see them. And so we were driving late at night on that Friday the 13th. And I remember as I was listening to the news about all the deaths and about the cytokine storm and the similarities to what we were dealing with, I remember finding myself hoping and praying that some research lab somewhere would follow our footsteps, would follow our blueprint of the work that we had done to find a treatment for Castleman disease, the work that we had been pioneering for other cytokine storm disorders. And then about a minute later, I realized, why am I hoping that someone somewhere is going to do this? I'm alive today because I went from hoping that someone somewhere would find a treatment for me to turning my hope into action. And so I decided that moment that I would dedicate my time and my team's time towards trying to find treatments and solutions for COVID-19. But where are we today in 2021? Well, on the screen, you can see where we were back in 2012 in white, and I'm going to superimpose where we are today in blue. So back then, there was about $10,000 a year going towards Castleman's research. Today, we've raised about $1.5 million for IMCD research. We've spent that $1.5 million on the most important research studies all around the world. And based on those studies and based on really exciting and preliminary findings, external organizations have donated and funded an additional $10.1 million in research into Castleman disease. Of course, we never could have raised $11 million for research, but we could raise $1.5 million. We could spend it really wisely. And because we spent it so well, other organizations saw the progress and funded those studies further, now to about $11.5 million. The NIH gave my lab the first grant for Castleman disease couple of years ago. We now have over 1,200 patients in our registry. There were two organizations that existed before us, but now all three of us have joined together into one collaborative network with a unified research agenda, one biobank where we can share samples. We can work to answer many questions that still remain. There's now a diagnostic criteria. There's a checklist that doctors can go through to diagnose patients. There are treatment guidelines. What do you do first? What do you do second? What do you do third? There are even blood tests you can run to predict whether someone's going to benefit from one drug or another drug. There's now an FDA-approved treatment. The drug that didn't work for me, thankfully, is life-saving for about one-third to one-half of patients, and that's now FDA-approved, which is amazing. And now there are two drugs in development. The drug I'm on, sirolimus, is undergoing clinical trial. And there's another drug that's coming down the pipeline that we're really excited about. As I mentioned earlier, the similarities with COVID. The picture on the left side of the screen is of a Castleman's patient in the ICU, on a ventilator, on dialysis, struggling to survive from Castleman's. And on the right, it's a COVID patient in the ICU, on a ventilator, on dialysis, struggling for survival. And if you look at the blood of a Castleman's patient and a COVID patient, it's almost indistinguishable what is happening in their immune systems. It's very, very similar. And unfortunately, so much of the work that we've done for Castleman disease over the last decade has become incredibly relevant for COVID. I say unfortunately, because I wish so badly that what happened in Castleman's was not something that's now associated with this terrible pandemic. But thankfully, we've been doing this work for the last decade. And thankfully, we could apply this work towards COVID. So we launched the Corona Project with the goal of centralizing data on all treatments that have been given to COVID patients worldwide, so that in one central place, we can get a sense for what looks promising, what looks less promising, and then we can move forward the most promising treatment towards randomized controlled trials. Anyone can access the data at cdcn.org/corona. I should mention and thank that we had a team, and we have had a team of over 90 volunteers that have reviewed over 29,000 papers to put the data together in one central place, all volunteers doing this in their nights and weekends, extracted data on over 270,000 COVID patients. We identified over 400 drugs that have been tried for COVID. You guys have heard about a handful in the news, but actually there have been over 400 treatments. And I should mention, when we started doing this from that Friday the 13th of March decision, it was supposed to be a 10-day challenge where we'd spend 10 days doing this, learn as much as we could. But 10 days in, we learned that actually we were the only people doing this, and we were uniquely positioned to continue to do this And here we are over a year later, continuing to track and identify promising drugs. We make the data all freely available. We've partnered with the NIH, Google Health, and FDA. We're actually, I now serve on a working group for the NIH that's selecting drugs for a large clinical trial, and similarly with the FDA. Trying to bring data, all of this data into one place to help to inform these really important decisions, which we published over the last year. So I'm just going to close this is my last slide with a handful of lessons. I mentioned earlier that I wrote Chasing My Cure because I learned so many lessons about life and hope and resilience, lessons that have fundamentally changed who I am, how I live, and what I do on a daily basis that I just felt so compelled to share with the world. I didn't know these things before I went through all that I went through, and I felt like I should share them with the world so you all can just read a book instead of having to have your last rites read to you or go through the medical challenges that I've gone through. And so I pulled out a handful of those lessons here, but obviously don't have time to go through all of them. The first one is really about hope, and hope is in the subtitle of my book, A Doctor's Race to Turn Hope into Action. There's the kind of hope that goes to the Duke Brain Tumor Center. You know that it's the best place in the world, and you can be hopeful because you know you are in the best place. And that is really important and really, really meaningful. It helped me and my family so much. But there's also the kind of hope that says, I'm going to go to the best place in the world. I'm going to go to Little Rock, Arkansas, which is the best center in the world for Castleman disease, but I'm not going to stop at going to Little Rock, just getting to Little Rock. When I'm in Little Rock, I'm going to figure out what can I contribute my samples to? What can I contribute my data to? What can I do? What actions can I take to get closer to that which I'm hoping for? And in my case, it was starting a foundation. It was starting conducting laboratory research. It was searching for treatments. It was raising money for research. These action steps are why I'm alive today. And I think it's so important to recognize that hope is so important, but sometimes hope can be paralyzing. Sometimes when we hope for something, that's when we stop. We hope for it, and then we wait for it. But I really hope everyone watching and listening that you'll reflect on what you hope for. I'm not saying don't be hopeful. I'm a very hopeful person. But when I hope for something, I then ask myself, what can I do today, tomorrow, and the next day to try to get closer to that which I'm hoping for? And who is my team that I've got, or what's the team I need to build so that way I have my best shot at achieving that thing that I'm hoping for? The second is for the gentleman in the room, but truly everyone listening in. I hope none of you are ever confused as your father's pregnant wife. But if you are confused as your father's pregnant wife, I hope you'll find some humor in that and all of life's challenges. During my toughest times, laughing with the people I love was the only thing I could do to get through them. The third lesson is that solutions can be hiding in plain sight. The drug that I'm on that's literally saving my life so I can talk to you tonight was around for all of those years when I was in and out of the ICU. It was at my neighborhood pharmacy as I was struggling for survival, but no one had thought to try it because it had never been used before for Castleman disease. And the research hadn't been done to connect Castleman disease to sirolimus. When I think about bigger than Castleman disease, bigger than my experience, and I think about the fact that there are about 2,500 drugs that are approved by the FDA for at least one thing. And they're approved for about a total of 3,000 human diseases. But there are another about 7,000 diseases that affect humans where we have zero treatments. How many of the 2,500 drugs that are already approved for something might actually be treatments or even cures for some of the 7,000 diseases that don't have any solutions? Unfortunately, that work won't happen if we just hope that someone somewhere will do it. So I've launched two initiatives, one in partnership with the FDA called CureID, another one with the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, to create systems so that all drugs approved for anything can be used for everything that they can be effective for. It seems like a no-brainer, right? If a drug is approved for one thing, we should be able to know all of the other diseases that it could be helpful for and use it for all those diseases. But unfortunately, it won't happen if we just hope it'll happen. We have to create initiatives to turn our hope into action. And we're doing everything we can. This is what keeps me up at night and what I spend so much of my time on now. And it's really also one of the reasons why I wrote Chasing My Cure is to be able to highlight the power of drug repurposing, when you can take a drug that was developed for one thing and use it in additional ways. The fourth lesson is that in overtime, we have to maximize our impact. And as I said at the beginning, I feel like I'm in overtime, but the truth is we're all in overtime. None of us know the time we have, but all of us know that the time we have must be precious. We don't know how long we have, but every minute, every day, every fraction of a month, a week, a day, an hour is precious, and we have to make the most of our time. And we have to use it to not be afraid of the limited time, but really to create clarity around what's important in life. And then the last lesson I wanted to close with is that it really takes all of us working together. My book is called Chasing My Cure, but it really should have been called Chasing Our Cures, because the work we're doing is so much bigger than just me or my case or even my disease. But it's really about chasing our cures together, because if it was just me working on my own, we would have made none of the progress that we have. But really, so many of you, I saw some of the names of people we're first starting out, friends, longtime friends from Raleigh, even friends from outside of Raleigh that are virtually connected in. So many of you have been a part of this journey, chasing our cures together. You've posted about our work on social media. You've donated to CDC and research. You've bought a copy of Chasing My Cure for someone you've loved or someone you love. It's just been incredible to see the support that you all have given to our work. Even those of you who have been with us ever since our AMF days, when we were supporting grieving college students in memory of my mom, which continues still to this day. So I'm just so thankful for all of you for being a part of this effort, Chasing Our Cures. Of course, I have to also thank so many people on my team. These are just some of many people who are part of our Army doing the Castleman Warrior Flex. And again, I'm so thankful to all of you for everything you do to support our fight. You can learn more about the work we do at cdcn.org. You can also learn about our bigger mission and our broader mission to chase cures for many more diseases at chasingmycure.com. And I hope you'll help to raise awareness about chasing my cure and about these lessons that I learned about living from nearly dying so that you don't have to go through all the same things that I did. Thank you all so much. I think we've got some time for some Q&A.
Sure, Fajgenbaum. Wow. I don't even know what to say, except thank you so much for taking time to share your incredible journey with us and for all the incredible, impactful work that you do to help others. And before I ask anyone's questions, I just want to say congratulations on 86.61 months. That is incredible.
Thank you so much, Stacey.
So we have quite a few questions. We'll do as many as we can. The first one is from Anne, and she asks, what were your first symptoms of your disease? And at what point did you decide you needed treatment?
I was a medical student at the time, and I started noticing I was really, really tired. And I think all medical students are tired. So it was kind of hard to know, was it that I'm just working too hard or what's going on here? But when I found myself, and I described this a lot in Chasing My Cure, I actually would see a patient in a hospital room, and then I would go find an empty room in the hospital, and I would go take a nap in the empty room for like 5 minutes. And I would set an alarm on my phone for 5 minutes. So I could sleep for 5 minutes, go see another patient, go back and sleep for 5 minutes, see a patient. It was fatigue that was so unbearable that I literally had to take these 5 minute naps 15, 20 times a day, in addition to drinking lots of Red Bull and lots of coffee. So it was this unbearable, almost insatiable fatigue that was the first sign. And I kept putting it off because I was focused on the rotation I was on. And I eventually went to the hospital. And by the time I went to the hospital, my organs were already shutting down.
Marge says, like you, I went almost 5 years before being diagnosed with different conditions that were not life-threatening, but affected my quality of life. There were many doctors who tried to tell me my symptoms were related to stress, and others said they couldn't help me. How has what you've been through medically affected how you think of the medical community?
I think that it made me realize a lot of things that it sounds like you've realized, and I'm saying that to the person who's asking the question, and that I've realized that it's important to trust your doctor. It's really important to trust your doctor, but it's also important to trust your gut. And if your doctor is not solving the problem in front of you, you can try to keep working with him or her, but sometimes you just have to go to a new doctor. And sometimes you just have to find someone else who maybe has more experience with something that you're dealing with. I mean, it sounds like you did that, and that's what you've got to do. So I think it's, you know, all of us, we want to go to our doctor and we want her to look at us and say, this is what's wrong with you. And this is the drug you're going to get and you're going to be just fine. That's what we all want. But the reality is for many diseases, it's not that simple. And so sometimes the first doctor you go to is not going to have all the answers. Sometimes you have to go see additional doctors.
Pamela asks, is Castleman's disease one that can be inherited or a potential outcome from another medical disease or condition?
It's a good question. It's one of the things that we're spending a lot of time trying to figure out. Less than 5% of all Castleman's patients have a family member with Castleman disease. So in very rare cases, it can be inherited, but it's extraordinarily rare relative to all of the cases where there aren't multiple people within the family. So it could be that it's a what's called a de novo genetic mutation where it spontaneously occurs, or it may be that it's not genetic in origin. So that's the work we're doing. It's called idiopathic. Idiopathic's the fancy term to say we don't know what causes it.
John asks, what advice would you give to people with undiagnosed disorders who are chasing a diagnosis, even with many more online resources available now than ever, much precious time can be wasted. Any best practices?
I think the number one thing is go to your doctor who's familiar with your case, you know, whoever your doctor is that maybe you've been seeing for years, kind of figure out, you know, what the next step is from that doctor. Is there someone that they recommend going to? And try to make sure that if you get a hint that it might be something, if that person that's the expert for that disease is within driving distance, just get in your car. And just if it's 14 hours, you got to drive in your car to go see someone, just get in your car and go. My dad and I went to Little Rock, Arkansas to see the world expert for Castleman's. And that's really what was a turning point in my journey. And so I think that if you get a hint that it might be some disease and you know that the expert for that disease is somewhere that you can drive to, just go. Just get in your car and go. Go see that person. See if they can tell you yes or no. And if not, there are also programs called the Undiagnosed Disease Program that the NIH has set up. And I highly recommend looking into that.
Patrick asks, has COVID research resulted in any new drugs that were not known prior to 2020 that may benefit IMCD patients?
Yeah, so in particular, a drug that targets a particular part of the immune system called JAK, JAK1 and JAK2. Over the course of this past year, we've had a lot of convergence in our lab and finding that this particular communication line, like mTOR, seems to be active in both Castleman's and in COVID. And so it's really there's been a lot of synergy here where basically we look at data from Castleman's patients, data from COVID patients, we find what's similar, what's different. And that's just one of a number of similarities that we're actively pursuing.
One of our attendees says they have read your book and love it. Any plans to write a second book?
For now, there are no plans. I do have to say that it has meant so much to me to hear from readers about what the book has meant to them. I mean, it really, with as many low points as my family has endured over the last 15 years, when there can be positives from this awful journey, when someone can get inspiration or kind of clarity or purpose based on reading about my journey and what my family's gone through, it feels so good. I mean, it feels good hearing that. And I love hearing from readers about what this book has meant to them. I think that if I were to ever write a book or when I write my next book, I think that it would be hard for me to write it on anything other than this idea of drug repurposing, the idea of using drugs in many ways, because like I said, that's the thing that keeps me up at night. The idea that there are drugs right now that are at my neighborhood pharmacy that could be a treatment for someone in my neighborhood, but we just don't know about it. To me, that's a tragedy. And to me, that's something that we in the medical community have to solve. We can't wait for some random med student somewhere to get sick with Castleman to figure out that sirolimus is an option. We in the medical community, we have to figure out ways to make sure every drug that's approved for one thing is also used for everything else that could be helpful for.
We'll close with this. It's not so much of a question. So many messages in chat thanking you for your work and saying what an inspiration you are. Patrick says, as a fellow IMCD patient, I raced home today for my 44th infusion treatment to watch this webinar. Your efforts are truly inspiring. The hope that COVID-19 pandemic would end inspired me and my wife to volunteer at COVID-19 vaccination superstations to help get 12,000 plus San Diegans vaccinated to help this pandemic. Likewise, I will always support CDCN for raising awareness. Thank you.
Oh, Patrick, I love that. And that's turning hope into action. I mean, that's, you know, you're hoping that this pandemic is going to end soon. I think all of us are, I know all of us are hoping that. And then you said, what can I do to be a part of it? I love it. So yeah, that's the perfect way to end this is let's all reflect on what we're hoping for, and then let's go do what we can to turn our hope into action.
Thank you all so much for joining us this evening. And again, Dr. Fajgenbaum, thank you so much for all of your time and your inspiration and your tireless work. We are so grateful.
Thanks so much, Stacey.
All of you, this program will be recorded, as I mentioned in the chat, and be available on the museum's YouTube page within a week of this evening's program. We will see you at our next program. In the meantime, stay safe, be well, and take care.
So I'm going to make one last plug, and that's that I actually have 14 job openings right now at my team. Half of them are for COVID work, half of them are for Castleman's work, and I'm looking for the best and the brightest people who want to be a part of taking down COVID. So if you're interested, if you know someone who's interested, whether you've got a medical background or not, we've got a number of roles that are open. And so I hope you will, if you go to chasingmycure.com or you go to cdcn.org/corona, you can learn more about those job postings. And I hope you'll help us to spread the word about it.
And I just put that in the chat as well. So please go check those out.
Thanks, Stacey.
Thanks, take care, everybody.